3 years ago, almost to the day, I opened a sermon with this song. Let's play it. Get your snap.
Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry, be happy. In every life we have some trouble, but when you worry you make it double. Don't worry, be happy.
Don't worry. Be happy now. All right. Go home. It's Father's Day. Yeah, some of you are going to do it. And that's quite all right. Don't worry. Be happy. That's pretty much what Jesus is saying here, only he gives us some good reasons to not worry and be happy. Remember the four G's that we've done here before? The four G's, what are they? God is great, therefore I do not need to be in control. He's in control. I can trust him. God is glorious, therefore I don't need to be afraid of any person. Any person. Remember the illustration I gave you when I was 12, 13 years old, my 20-year-old brother used to throw hard balls at me. He would, and he is 6'4". I was maybe, you know, at the time, 5'2 or 5'3, whatever I was at 13. Believe me, after I took pitches from my brother, I feared no one my age. It's kind of the same thing here. God is glorious, therefore we do not need to fear any person. God is good, therefore we do not need to look anywhere else. He has our best interests at heart all the time. He's good. And then finally, God is gracious. Therefore, I do not have to continually prove myself. His grace has set me free. I am free, and his truth has set me free. But we choose to be neurotic. We choose to be neurotic. We are becoming more and more a neurotic culture. The TikTok, the hashtag trauma. By the way, Adam, you like this? This is like a more recent sermon illustration. I took no end of grief from certain parties about the fact that my sermon illustrations are from the 80s or before. So this one is more recent, TikTok. Everybody. Now all you old people, I've lost you. All right. Hashtag trauma has more than 6 billion views. That's billion. Like I was going to say the guy from the 80s who used to do those things with the billions of stars, but I'll neglect that, all right? 6 billion views. And there are over 5,500 podcasts with the word trauma in the title. That's who we are. We all know that worry is bad, right? We all know it. We all know that that worry brings about indecisiveness, feelings of helplessness, panic attacks, difficulty concentrating on everyday tasks, lack of confidence. I found out before we came out on stage today that some people on our worship team just go nuts when they have red marks on their phones, red numbers. You know what those are? Okay, like, you have your, get your phone out. Okay, this is also a past 80s sermon illustration. Go to your emails on your phone. What numbers above your email, what numbers do you have there? I have 17,417. That's why you haven't heard from me if you sent an email. What that means is I have not read that many emails. Now, I read the important ones. But that means I have 17, and before the service it was 29,000. I did a quick read all. But some people, and I have one above messages here, and on my calendar I have the number 4, and on my text messages it's 242. All right. I'm not one who keeps my phone up to date with all of that stuff. Some of you would have an absolute conniption to see that on my phone. It would drive you nuts. Why? Well, because I don't worry. And you do. Doesn't bother me. I know that I've read the important emails. I don't care what the number is on my phone. I'm free. At least I try to be. So worry and anxiety are always with us, and we all acknowledge that it's not good, and Jesus agrees, but rather than tell us, just don't worry, be happy, he gives us some good reasons, so he's actually a little more helpful than Bobby McFerrin is. And it's a little bit ironic, of course, and this is serious, that Robin Williams is in that video, one who took his life just 10 years ago almost now, because of what? Anxiety over probably a health thing. So, there we go. So here's the focus question today. What reasons does Jesus give us to trust God and live a carefree existence regarding our physical needs? So here we go. It's Father's Day. I'll try to get you out of here in record time. Because there are more important concerns. That's the first reason to live a carefree existence regarding the physical stuff. Because there are more important concerns. Here's the passage. And he said to his disciples, "Therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat, nor about your body, what you will put on. For life is more than food, and the body more than clothing." Now we've heard Jesus say that just in the previous context, that life consists of more than just the stuff you have, right? We've already heard him say that. The word anxious here literally means to take no thought. To take no thought. Anxiety is an emotion characterized by an unpleasant state of inner turmoil, often accompanied by nervous behavior such as pacing back and forth or rumination or subjectively unpleasant feelings of dread over anticipated events. Just kind of lingering there, always with us, undefined most of the time. Therefore, it's always oriented to the future and not the present. Worry is above all oriented to the future and not the present. And guess what? Most of the time, we can either do nothing about it or it never happens. And yet, that's what we live. Jesus wants us to live in the now, right? Give us this day our daily bread. When God gave manna in the wilderness to the children of Israel, go get it every day. Don't collect more than a day's worth, except before the Sabbath, before Shabbat. Then you can get 2 days' worth. There's a point that he's trying to make to us, and that is he will take care of us. He will provide our daily needs. So, Jesus says there's something more important. One is given strength to bear what happens to a person, but not the 105 different things that might not happen. And when we live there, we're living in a place that we can't do anything about. The word for life here is the word psuche. Life consists of more. It's the kind of life we get from our parents. It's where we get the word soul from. We have both a physical and an immaterial existence, right? We have physical bodies. We have immaterial souls and spirits. If you make the mistake of thinking that life is only material, you're destined to lose both that and your soul that goes along with it. However, if you do not buy into the life that life is only consists of the physical realm, and you are willing to give up that life to Jesus, then you gain a new kind of life, the Zoe kind of life that the Bible talks about. This life comes from God. You don't lose what you have, but you gain what you do not have. That's the promise of Scripture. Life is more than food. The body is more than clothing. You will never hear Jesus say that the material world is bad in and of itself. So don't mistake that. Or that it's not real. If that had been the case, Jesus would never have taken a physical body and become a man. God created the physical universe, pronounced it good in Genesis. And when God finally makes everything right. He is going to the new heavens and the new earth are going to fulfill all of the purposes that God made the original earth for. The material world that God made is good. But life does not consist of just that. We are spirit. We are soul. And that's the message that Jesus wants to get across. So that's what he means. Your life is a lot more than just what you eat, what you drink, and what you put on. It's a tragedy to squander it. We betray that we know that, even in our consumerism. Again, a great book I've recommended to you, but it's not for the light of heart. It's a massive book. It's called Biblical Critical Theory by Christopher Watkin. He may have written it, I don't know. See, some of you knew who he was. All right. And he says this, the crucial factor in determining purchases today is not the inherent quality of the product, but the meanings and the identities associated with it. Not the leather and foam of the sneaker, but the spiritual meaning of the swoosh. So our problem is that since we have given up defining spiritual meaning in relationship with God, we are trying to do it in relationship to stuff. In the end, Nike is just a sneaker, not a transcendent concept. So we know that life is more than just the physical. And we try to put that spiritual meaning into stuff that just can't bear it. And that's the craziness of advertising at times. So, you've been given your soul. If you give your soul only to material possessions, you will have a lot of anxiety. Why? Well, because you can lose it. It can be taken from you. It's never enough, is it? And you'll be forever comparing yourself with others. So Jesus says, stop being anxious because there are a lot bigger and more important things than what you eat, drink, and wear. Your life is not measured by those things. Life is not just materialistic. That's the first reason not to worry. Secondly, because you are more important to God than unclean birds and short-lived flowers. You are more important to God than unclean birds and short-lived flowers. Consider the ravens. They neither sow nor reap. They have neither storehouse nor barn. Remember last week, the guy was going to build bigger barns, right? Jesus kicks off with that idea. They have neither storehouse nor barn, and yet God feeds them. Of how much more value than you are birds? And then to verse 27, consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I tell you, even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Here's the punchline. But if God so clothes the grass, which is alive in the field today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? Here's some ravens. What do they eat? Caterpillars, beetles, rodents, lizards, probably a lot of other stuff too. Here's some ravens on a carcass. I don't know what the carcass is, but most of the meat's gone. And by the way, if those natural things aren't there, ravens can always go to the trash can. God feeds them abundantly. That's ravens. And by the way, ravens in the Old Testament are unclean birds. Can't eat a raven because they're unclean. God cares about unclean birds. He makes sure they get enough to eat. This last week, they're not ravens, they're close to ravens, though crows. How many of you love the call of crows in the morning? 5:30, and one person does, all right. I'll see you afterwards, we can go talk about it. Okay. Crows, 5:30, I don't like them at 5:30. I don't like them many times, but 5:30 in the morning, I really don't like them. And they were just, there was a bunch of just cawing up a storm, so I got up, got one outside. And as soon as I opened my door to the outside, the first thing I noticed was a crow, kind of hot. It was wounded. And then quickly thereafterwards, a cat scampered up over the fence and out into the big lawn behind us. You know what was going on there. The cat found a meal. a wounded raven or wounded crow, and the rest of the crows were trying to protect that one. So I went and I picked it up and see if it could fly. I threw it up and it could fly. So I thought, good, it's out of here. Except 2 hours later when I was mowing the lawn, Gus had it cornered. And so I had to pick it up and I performed a euthanasia for a crow. Just it was not going to live much longer. God closed those, and he knew about that crow. He numbers our very heads, Matthew tells us in the same context. Oh, you of little faith. That's a term that Jesus kind of coined. It's one word in Greek. Little faiths would be the way to say it. So those are ravens, unclean birds. The argument is from the lesser to the greater, right? Since God feeds unclean birds, don't you think he can take care of you, feeding you? Again, the word consider is looked at, and now he moves from birds to flowers, lilies. He probably had in mind water lilies. And then this is what they look like in Middle Eastern places. They're pretty. They're beautiful, right? Consider the lilies. Flowers are beautiful, but in the end of the day, they're like grass, though. God sees fit to clothe them in beauty, but they don't last. They don't last, but God cares for them. How much more will he clothe you? He'll take care of those needs. I don't see anybody with a lack of clothes here, which is probably a good thing. So that's, God is great. Therefore, I don't need to be in control. It is a theological matter, right? Oh, you of little faith, Jesus says. A.W. Tozer, a great writer, puts it this way in theological perspective. If only we would stop lamenting and look up. God is here. Christ is risen. The Spirit has been poured out on us. All of this we know as theological truth, and it remains for us to turn it into a joyful spiritual experience every day. Those truths don't end. They're real. They're just as real as the problem you're facing. And so Jesus says, look to that. Oh, don't be a one of little faith. Don't be a little faith. Be a big faith. Trust him. All right. Another reason, because worry is non-productive. It's non-productive. Back to verse 25. And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his lifespan? If then you are not able to do as small a thing as that, why are you anxious about the rest? I don't know if it'd be a small thing to add a minute to your life. That may be a big thing for a lot of us, right? Jesus says it's a small thing. If you can't even do that, why are you so? In other words, worry is non-productive. We're worried too much about the stuff we have no control over. We're worried too much about the stuff in the future that's probably never going to happen. And it is taking all the joy away from us today. We are not living in the moment where God dwells. Remember God's name, I am. That is present tense, folks. I am. Now, he's also the Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, and all of that. But his name is I am. I am. I'm here in the moment. Trust me here, now. That's the only thing you can do anything about anyway. It's that simple. We can't carry worry into a longer life. It's out of our control. The definition of neurosis is excessive and irrational anxiety or obsession. And that defines our worry. It's mostly irrational. Okay, another non-80s sermon illustration. Sheldon Cooper from Big Bang Theory. It's all about logic, right? It's all about logic. That's his whole life. Life is logic. And yet, he can't stop worrying about things like being to the airport 6 hours before the flight. Even in our logic, we get a little messed up and we betray that we worry too much. How much emotional energy do we spend on things that either need to just a simple action will take care of it and solve it, or on something that's completely out of our control? And that is wasted energy. Worry does not empty tomorrow of its sorrow, it empties today of its strength. And that's what Jesus is trying to set us free. George MacDonald, great writer, influenced C.S. Lewis greatly, wrote this: "No man ever sank under the burden of the day. It is when tomorrow's burden is added to the burden of today that the weight is more than a person can bear." Never load yourself so. If you find yourself so loaded, at least remember this: it is your doing and not God's. He begs you to leave the future with Him and to mind the present. Worry is irrational. Another reason: because there is something greater for us to seek and receive. Turn our thoughts. Have you ever noticed when you're told to not do something, that's all you can think about? Is what you're not supposed to do? Jesus is smarter than that. He's the smartest person who ever lived. He understands human psychology better than the greatest psychologist of our day. He never takes something away without reminding us there's something better to replace it with. So the command not to worry is exchanged with, okay, here's what you can do. So here we are. "And do not seek what you are to eat and what you are to drink, nor be worried. For all the nations of the world seek after these things, and your Father knows that you need them. Instead, seek His kingdom, and these things will be added to you. Fear not, little flock." I love this. Here he gets tender. "Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." All right, so do not seek. Stop seeking is a good way to put that. Stop spending a lot of time and emotional energy and worry, because if you do, you're being just like everyone else around you who doesn't know that God exists or who rejects His existence and have replaced Him with the stuff that He made, according to Romans chapter 1. They have exchanged the truth of God for a lie and have begun serving and worshiping the creature rather than the Creator. And that's the exchange that we all tend to make without God's movement in our life. Stop seeking all of that stuff. Now, Luke uses a different word for worry this time. He says, "And don't worry." Before, the translator, "do not be anxious." Here the word is translated worry, a different word. Normally, it's a word that means to be lifted up or puffed up, and it can also mean overbearing. This is the only place where it's used in the New Testament. And in this context, it paints a picture of anxious, emotional insecurity and instability as it races between various emotions. In other words, this paints a picture of a person who is totally out of control with worry. Just frantic and frenetic in everything the person does. This is a person that's worked up, and you've seen that before. You've probably seen it in children. You know, they're so worried about something, they just get so worked up and afraid. And you're trying to calm them down, but all they can think about is the thing they're afraid of. The reason we should not get worked up is because God is aware of our basic needs. Jesus says, "Your Father knows you need this stuff." Okay, so remember that. He knows that. Remember, most sin is an attempt to meet a legitimate need in an illegitimate way. And that's often what worry does to us. We have a legitimate need. We're worried it's not going to get filled. And so rather than turn to God, "God, I have this need. Would you please?" We begin to devise our own ways. And it's all through the Bible. God promised Abraham, "You're going to have a son." Sarah said, "Oh, I don't think that's true. I think you ought to have my handmaid be the mom. Maybe that's the way God wants to do this." That wasn't the way God wanted to do that. And every time we make a choice like that, we tend to have to live with the consequences of it. I have never regretted trusting God. I have very often regretted trusting myself and living with the consequences of that. And you've probably experienced this too. Now, this is where we may begin to look foolish to people around us as we entrust ourselves to the care of our Father, excuse me, as Jesus did. We live life very differently. We are not eaten up by concern regarding the economy or our investments or our basic needs. Sure, we take care of things, but we're not overcome with neurosis about it. You know that your Father is perfectly aware of all the latest bad economic news. And somehow, He is not in heaven. Oh no! Oh, the stock market's just crashed. What am I going to do? Look at all my children down there. I can't, oh my God. This doesn't throw Him. He is totally capable of meeting our needs. He is never overwhelmed by any situation. God is great. Therefore, I do not need to be in control. God is glorious. Therefore, I don't need to be afraid of the housing market or the economy or inflation. He knows all of that. So that's the negative, but what's the positive? Instead of not worrying, try this. Replace one seeking with another. So Jesus said, don't spend all your time seeking after that. Here's what you can spend your time doing. Seek the kingdom of God. And then all of these other things will be added unto you. That's also the same as in Matthew 6:33. Seek, it's a present tense verb, which means continuous action. Keep seeking in your life. Instead of that stuff, put your mind here, seek this stuff. Seek God's kingdom. What is God's kingdom? Seems to be kind of a nebulous concept with us. Well, God's kingdom is wherever God's rule, wherever God's will is being done, we pray for God's kingdom to come and His will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. And I think seeking God's kingdom is a simple matter of us asking ourselves a question: what would this area of my life look like if God really were in control of it? If His will really was being done. So what would my home look like if God were truly ruling it? What would my bank account look like if God were truly ruling it? What would my investments look like? We're not told not to invest. In fact, go to Proverbs, lots of verses on investing for the future. That's wise. But don't worry about it. But what would our investments look like if God were truly in control? What would my retirement look like if God were truly ruling it? What would my college life look like if God were truly in control? What would my dating life look like if God were truly in control? What would my marriage look like if God were truly in control? What would my parenting and my grandparenting look like if God was truly ruling it? That is seeking God's kingdom and His will to be done on earth. So you get the idea. With the call to trust, a promise is given that the Father is pleased to give His children the kingdom. Now, verse 32 here is transitional. It connects everything that Jesus has just said with what's going to come afterwards, and that's for next week. And so the sermon ends with this verse, verse 32, and next week's sermon will begin with it. The verse, "Do not fear, little flock." Again, words of tenderness. The disciples, since they're following Jesus, had a lot of good reasons to fear. They had already seen Him have some encounters with the Pharisees, and He gave them every indication that some tough times were ahead. So they had a lot of reasons, probably more reasons to fear than we do. And so He pulls them, "Don't be afraid, little flock." Little flock, it means fragile yet cared for people. We are not the gathering of the high and mighty. Have you ever noticed that? Just look around. Look up here. None of us. And Paul knew this. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, he is writing this great passage on the foolishness of God versus the wisdom of men. And he writes, "For the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many of you were powerful. Not many of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God." When we are weak, Paul says, or when I am weak, I am strong. Therefore, I will glory in my weakness, because that's when Christ's power becomes very evident. The best thing that could be said about me or about you is not how wise, talented, smart, powerful we are, but how much Christ was reflected in the abilities that he gave us and the gifts that he gave us. How much people notice Jesus in me and in you. The promise of the kingdom, therefore, is not specified or described in detail, but I showed you some ways that we can look at that. But we do know that the kingdom of God is coming in power. And Jesus says, don't be afraid. God delights in giving you the kingdom. He provides for the basics right now. And one of the ways he does that is through the gift of the Holy Spirit. Paul writes in Romans 8:16, and I want the men's chorus to come up as we close this off. "The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God." The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, what's the next word, those of you who know the Bible? Heirs. And if children, heirs. That means we inherit something. Heirs of God and fellow heirs of Christ. Everything that Christ has, we who are connected to him get. If indeed we suffer with him, so that we may be glorified with him. So the Holy Spirit is telling you, he's telling me, daily, minute by minute, you are a child of God. Don't worry. Don't worry. Everything that Jesus has, you get. Your Father is taking care of you. You are one of his children. He loves you. He is not going to leave you unattended. He cares for you. Here's an application step for us today. Make a list of things you're worried about. So on my list will not be that I have some red numbers on my phone, but there'll be other things that I'm worried about. If there's an action you need to take, simply take it. Just do it. And pray for favor as you take it. And then leave the results with your Father in heaven. If your worry betrays a lack of faith or failure to focus your life on the things that matter to God, then confess it and allow the Spirit to redirect your priorities. Let's pray. The men are going to sing a song called My Creed. And it's a good song to end things with today, because it says we're going to live what we believe. And if we truly believe that God is there taking care of us, then we don't need to worry. We can be happy. I might be worried about this because I think this is what I drank from last week. So I'll consider that to be true. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Pray it with me. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. 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 Let's pray. Our Father, thank you for your protective care over us at all times. And may we truly live like you're there and you're active and you're listening because you are. We have so many promises here. So Father, I know it's not easy. It is not easy. But we are your little flock. And you care greatly for us. Just as we care for those that are weaker than ourselves, Lord, you care for us. Help us to internalize that for all we're worth. And when we get overwhelmed with care, with worry, to turn it over to you and stop seeking the things that make more care and worry, but seek you and your kingdom. And all of those things, Lord, will fade by comparison. Thank you. In your name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful Father's Day, and we'll see you next week.